So there's these questions we all ask, big questions that have a huge effect on our lives. But there's all this information out there that makes finding a solution difficult. So we came up with a better way to give you the answers that you need. We did a survey at Easter and compiled a list of your top 6 most asked questions. That list then became a roadmap for this message series. Each week, we'll examine a single question and discover God's answers based on His Word. It's a series we like to call You Asked For It.
All right, we are in our 6th week of You Asked For It. We have had a survey during Easter asking your questions, and one of the questions you asked is this: what about the LGBT community? What does God say about that? How do we deal? What does the Bible say about that? How do we help those that are in that lifestyle? And what does the Bible say about it? And it's a very controversial issue in our society today, but I'm so glad the Bible's not silent on it. And I'm so glad that the Bible gives us reasons and gives us the relationship with Jesus Christ, which shows us the way. I'm so delighted to invite our guest here today. Our guest goes to my brother David and Diane's church at Calvary Temple in New Jersey. And a great church, Pastor Lloyd, and he's been there for 30 years. And one of the people in their church is now speaking around the country, sharing her story and how God has set her free. Her name is Patty Height. And I just am so thrilled to have Patty. Patty, welcome to Cornerstone. Let's welcome her this morning as she shares the Word of God.
Thank you, Pastor Eric. Good morning, Cornerstone Church in beautiful Connecticut with the leaves. I think I saw a couple of trees on my way here that were green yesterday and they were red this morning, so that's awesome. Must be that Hunter's Moon that Pastor Eric was talking about. But as Pastor Eric said, he asked me to come here today and share my testimony, and I could actually say if we just did worship again, I could say, there you go. That's my testimony. What an amazing time that we get to worship the Lord together, the God of all creation. We can come together as one body, one functioning body in worship and praise the Lord. And how neat that we can worship Him through prayer. We can worship Him through the reading of the Word, and we can worship Him through song. And so thank you, worship team, wherever you are, for leading us in worship this morning. So this morning, I'm just going to start off by sharing 2 verses with you that I would like you to hold in your heart and your mind as I share my testimony today. And the first one is 1 Corinthians 13:1. I read through the New King James, and it says, "Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I have become sounding brass or a clanging cymbal." And before I share the next verse, I want to ask you a question, somewhat of a rhetorical question. But do you believe every word of the Bible is true? Then let's look at 1 Corinthians 13, verse 8a, because that says, love never fails. And if love never fails, then we do not ever have to sound like a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And keep that in mind, if you would, as I share my testimony. But as you listen, I want you to notice how my own perception, even my childhood perception that came from confusion and pain, led to deception, and that deception brought me into captivity of what, or bondage of what we as the church regularly call Egypt. But praise the Lord, God took me out of Egypt, and that's where He gave me the name for this ministry, Out of Egypt Ministries. But as a young child growing up in a neighborhood of all boys, at least in my section of the street, I fit right in because I actually thought I was a boy, not in a tomboy kind of way. I literally thought I was a boy. I didn't think there was any difference between the boys that I was playing with and me, not in a tomboy kind of way. Literally, deep inside, the essence of who I was, I thought I was a boy. And then probably around 5, 6 years old, that's when I realized something about me was a little bit different. My body wasn't like theirs. My body was telling me something different than what I was feeling inside. My body was telling me I was a girl. And this confused me. Not only did it confuse me, but it made me angry, so angry, even at that little age, I would have fits of rage. And then I started to self-injure at a very, very young age as well. I felt so different. And because I felt different, I felt like I wasn't worthy of love. I felt unloved. I was also angry and confused because of what I saw that was going on inside my home, where no one else could see and no one else could hear. I watched my parents have a verbally abusive relationship with each other. My dad, in front of us kids, would belittle my mother. He would say things like, you're worthless, you're useless, you're stupid, you're crazy. I watched my mom manipulate my dad, and my perception was that if she's manipulating him, she must not trust him. And so that perception led to an even further deception that, therefore, if my dad can't be trusted, no man can be trusted. I didn't feel close to either one of my parents. I didn't want to be like my mom, who was the representation of femininity to me, because I was afraid if I became like her, then I would also be crazy and useless and worthless. Because when I heard my dad say those things to her, I believed him because he's my dad. I didn't want to spend time or be around my dad because, you know, he was the embodiment of all men to me, but I didn't want to be around him because he was so angry all the time and so mean, and I hated the way he treated my mom, and really all women for that matter. So I separated from him as well. And I just want to point this out, that what I just shared is what the Lord showed me after I got saved, when I started asking him specific questions, which you'll hear in a little bit. I wasn't 6 years old walking around going, you know what, I kind of feel like I'm detaching from my mom. That's probably not going to end well for me. I was just trying to get by every day of life, being a very confused, abused, and hurt child. But again, these understandings and these insights that I just shared with you is what the Lord showed me after I got saved and asked him questions. So picking back up in the story, this part's always a little difficult to share, and I kind of keep it brief. But from the time I was a very little girl until I was about 12 years old, I was also being sexually violated. And again, my perception was, you know, I was trying to figure out, because our mind always tries to make sense of things, right? The mind just never stops, at least mine doesn't. So my mind was trying to make sense of what was happening in my life. So my perception was that sexual abuse only happens to little girls. So if I could somehow just become a boy, the sexual abuse would stop, because, I mean, I already feel like a boy anyways, but if I could just become a boy, certainly this sexual abuse would stop. That perception of mine led to the deception that I could somehow protect myself in doing that. I didn't understand there was a God who loved me. I didn't know there was a God that was sitting right there with me during those hard times, weeping and crying like I was. I didn't know there was a God I could turn to and cry to. When I was 10, 11, 12 years old, somewhere around that time, is when I really started to recognize that I liked girls in a special way. I didn't really understand what it was, but I knew it was different. I knew it scared me, and I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that I did not want it. I did not want these feelings that I had. I recognized that I started liking girls the same way the boys were liking the girls. And then when I got a little bit older in high school and puberty was setting in, then I started having these fantasies in my head of what she would be like to be a girlfriend, and just even deeper than that. So there wasn't anyone for me to talk to about this. I was born in 66, so junior high was in the 70s. I was in high school in the early 80s, and there was no one for me to talk to. There was nowhere for me to turn. I felt isolated and alone. So again, at a young age, I took matters into my own hands, and I started drinking when I was 12 years old. When I was 13, I started doing drugs. So much so that by the time I was 17 years old, I had done over 30 hits of LSD, which is a mind-altering drug, and cocaine, and every other drug I could find, I was just taking and using as often as I could because I did not want to be sober. Because when I was sober, the hurt and the pain and the confusion was just too much for me to handle. So when I graduated high school, which I have no clue, but by the grace of God that I graduated high school, my sister, who's 14 years older than me, was living in Florida with her family. She came up and grabbed me and brought me down to Florida to live with her. And after a short time of being there, I went to a party, which wasn't odd for me. I was a big partier. But what was different at this party is a guy asked me out on a date. And I'm like, okay, that's never happened before. I actually never dated anyone, a guy or a girl, in junior high or high school. I'd been sexually active at parties that I went to, but I never was in a relationship. No one had actually said, would you care to go out with me? So I said yes to this guy, and we went out on this date, and it was on this date that he proceeded to tell me that he had just been released from prison. So you would think that I would run in the other direction, but I was just so amazed that someone would be showing interest in me, in this sexually confused and gender confused body and mind that I had. Wow, someone was showing me interest. So I continued dating this guy, and just shy of a year of dating, we ended up getting married. I was 19 and he was 27. And I thought for sure, whew, I'm married now. Finally, my same-sex attraction and my gender confusion are gonna go away because I did not choose them. I didn't want them. I wanted it to go away. So I figured marriage was the cure. But shortly into the marriage, he became physically abusive to me. And so I thought in my mind, you know what? I gave this whole being straight thing a shot. I tried being with men relationally, and it is not working. That's it. Really, all men are bad. More deception. All men are bad, so I filed for a divorce and moved back up north. And when I got up here is when I came out as a lesbian. And please, please hear me when I tell you this. When I came out as a lesbian is when I felt freedom for the first time in my life. I felt free because I was doing anything I wanted now. I felt free because I was no longer pushing down these guttural desires that I'd had for as long as I could remember. But just because I felt free doesn't mean I was free. I thought what I was doing was bringing me into freedom, but it was actually bringing me into an even deeper bondage. Sin is deceptive. It's so deceptive that I thought what I was doing and the way I was living now wasn't even sin. I didn't even consider it that way. I didn't even look at the word. Sin wasn't even a word I used in my vocabulary. So I continued to drink and party like crazy. I had many sexual encounters with other women, and at first, it was great. It was fun for a season. I finally felt like I fit in somewhere. I was finally accepted, and I finally had a family, the LGBT community, and they were a good family. But then I became lonely in all of the one-night stands and the rocky short-term relationships, and I realized that what I wanted was a lifelong relationship with someone. I wanted to meet the woman of my dreams and live the rest of my life with her, and you know why? Because that's normal. Everyone wants to meet the person of their dreams and live happily ever after. I was no different because I was a lesbian. I just wanted it to be with a woman. So I met someone in the late 1990s, and we met, and we hit it off right away, and pretty much both of us knew right from the get-go, this was it. We were going to spend the rest of our lives together. And so we started living as a married couple. Marriage wasn't legal then, but we started living as a married couple. We owned a home together. We worked on this home. We did everything together. We had great friends in our neighborhood. Everyone in our neighborhood treated us as if we were a married couple. And so as we're growing in our relationship with each other, we started talking and discussing with each other that we both found we wanted to look into spiritual things. And do you know why? Because that's normal too. Just because I was a lesbian didn't mean I was an atheist. I didn't know who God was. Was he a tree? Was he Mother Earth? Was he an alien? I had no idea who this God was. So we started reading different books. But one thing we did know, we didn't read the Bible, and we didn't have anything to do with Christianity because of the Christians we saw. The only Christians we saw were the ones that we saw at Gay Pride Parade in New York City and in New Jersey. And every single time, every time we went to one of these parades, we saw what I would imagine were Christians holding up signs that said things like, God made Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. Homosexuals will burn in hell. God hates fags. And always this peculiar one that would just say, LEV 18:22. And I didn't know what that meant. I kind of figured it was a Bible verse, but interesting that a Bible verse is being held up right next to a sign that says, God hates fags, right? So needless to say, this didn't make us feel good about their God or welcomed into Christianity. And there you have it, church. The noise of a sounding brass and a clanging cymbal. All I heard was the loud, obnoxious noise of hate. But this is the exciting part. This is where like my countenance usually changes. But what I didn't know is that God was bigger than them, and he was bigger than those signs. And amen to that. And now I can share about how God met me right where I was. In 2001, my only brother, Larry, was actually diagnosed with lung cancer. And so, of course, this was devastating to our whole family. And I would go visit my brother quite often. And he also had someone else that was visiting him. There was a neighbor across the street from him that was a Christian. And he would grab his Bible every day at one point, probably after work, and come over and share the gospel with my brother. So very quickly, my brother believed and received the free gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. He was the first in our family to get saved. So even though the cancer was killing my brother, it was obvious. His skin was turning gray, his hair was falling out. So you could see that the cancer was killing him, but this life came alive inside of him, and I didn't know what it was, and I didn't know what to do with it, but it was alluring. It invited me, but yet it was like, whoa, I don't know. So I just stored that in my heart. Then on October 22nd, 2002, as I was holding my brother's hand in the hospital, I watched him take his last breath. My brother died right there in front of me, and it devastated me. Death became real to me for the first time in my life, and I didn't know what to do with it. My girlfriend tried to comfort me as best as she could, but when you don't know Jesus Christ, who is the resurrection and the life, how do you comfort someone when it comes to death? So I have all these thoughts and emotions now rolling through my brain and all these different things that I just wanted to understand, but I couldn't understand. But there was this one question just gnawing at my heart to share, and I wanted to share it with my girlfriend because not only was she my lover, but she was my best friend. She was the only person that I had trusted as much as I knew how to trust. I was fighting it, but praise the Lord, the Holy Spirit so present with me that day, the Holy Spirit was stronger than my fear. So I rolled over in bed And I looked her in the eye and I said, "Babe, do you think the way we're living is wrong?" And she had this shocked look on her face and she's like, "I can't believe you just asked me that. I was just gonna ask you the same thing." That's our God, you guys. Our God is not afraid to come all up inside our lesbian bedroom that day and make his presence known, because there's nowhere you can flee from his presence and there's nowhere he won't go to come and reach those that are his that are lost. And he did that day. So I said, "You know what? I think we should pray." So we got down on our knees in our lesbian bedroom and we cried out and said, "God, if you're real, will you show us? And if the way we're living is wrong, show us." So I'm like, "You know, my brother, I always saw him with a Bible, so we should grab ours." And we had one because we were Americans. So we went up in the attic to get it. And when we found which box it was in, we grabbed it out of the box and we opened it. And we didn't know where to turn. We didn't know what a concordance was or anything like that. So we're just flipping through, and it's not like the Holy Spirit left after he poked us on the shoulder in our bedroom. He was still there. And so when we landed where the Lord wanted us to land in his word, we looked at the top and there was this long, strange word and it said Leviticus. And then I remember on the left-hand side, I saw this bold number and it said 18. And as we scanned around, our eyes fell on verse 22. And there it is, Lev 18:22. And this is what we read right after we asked God that question. "You shall not lie with a male as with a woman. It is an abomination." And I want you to notice it says, "It is an abomination," not "they are an abomination," okay? So now that was talking about men, so we were like, maybe we're okay. We wanted to know if the Bible said anything about women. And so after about a week, my girlfriend comes home. She's like, "Yeah, I worked with a Christian, and I asked her if the Bible says anything about women being together, and she says there's this book called Romans, and we should read chapter 1. And so we did, because we were searching. We wanted truth. And so when we got to verses 26 and 27, we read this: "For this reason, God gave them up to vile passions, for even their women exchanged the natural use for what is against nature. Likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust for one another, men with men committing what is shameful and receiving in themselves the penalty of their error, which was due." So at this point, we knew we had to find a church, which was scary because churches are filled with, well, you know, Christians. So, but we found Calvary Chapel in Oldbridge, which is actually still where I go. And we walked in and we were welcomed in the sense that we weren't overwhelmed, like, "Yay, the lesbians are here. Yay, come sit with us." And we weren't underwelcome, like, "Oh my gosh, let them sit first so our kids don't sit next to them and then we have to explain to them what that means." We just walked in like everyone else. And we sat down and the worship music started and I'm thinking, but wait, where's Bart Simpson's mom? Shouldn't she be sitting like behind some pipe organ singing some like old-timey tunes or something? But no, there was a stage that looked just like this with all these guitars and drums. And so the music started playing and that was soothing to my soul. It kind of calmed me down a little. But then the words came up on the screen. And these words were talking about God's holiness and his righteousness and his love for me. And that ripped my heart wide open. And I'm like, "No, God, there's no way you could love me. I'm too dirty. I've done too many bad things. Too many bad things have happened to me, and I'm a lesbian. And those signs say you hated me." But God was moving in my heart through his Holy Spirit to tell me that wasn't true, that he loved me. And that's the difference between 1 Corinthians 13:1 and 1 Corinthians 13:8. Love never fails. So on January 19th, 2003, the best day of my life, I prayed and I asked God the Father to forgive me of my sins, for Jesus to be the Lord and the Savior in my life, and to be filled with his Holy Spirit. And man, I'm telling you, I was filled that day. I was so amazed that God loved me. I went from darkness to light, from deception to truth, truth that God loved me, and that truth set me free. Amen. Amen. I don't even remember what the message was about, but I remember that's the day I knew that God loved me. And that love caused an immediate change in my life. After 24 years of being addicted to drugs and alcohol, it ended that day, and so did my gay identity. My new identity was in Jesus Christ. Amen. But I had no clue what it was to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. But I knew I wanted to know everything that I could about God. So I started devouring the Bible. I read it every chance I got. Jeremiah 15:16 says, "For your words were found and I ate them. And your word was to me the joy and rejoicing of my heart, for I am called by your name, O Lord God of hosts." And so I knew the Bible had the answer to all the questions that I had. But even in that, I still had questions. And one of the biggest questions I had was, okay, God, if you're telling me I wasn't born gay, then why? Why does it feel so normal to me? And God, will you please show me everywhere I've been deceived? And Lord, please show me where I'm wrong and you're right. And that's when the Lord started showing me about the childhood stuff. The memories started coming back, and I was starting to be triggered by things. And let me tell you, that was really, really hard. But I asked him, and he answered, but he did this in his perfect patience and his perfect timing, because if he would have shown me all at once, it would have been way too overwhelming for me. So it took time. It takes time, doesn't it, folks? For the Lord to sanctify us and just continue that redemptive work that he started in us. But I was learning that I could trust him in everything. Anything he asked, I was like, okay, Lord, because he was God and he loved me. And one of the things that he asked me to do was to move out of the house of my now ex-girlfriend. And so when the Lord was showing me this and confirmed it to me, I told her and we prayed about it. Because on January 19th, 2003, she gave her heart to the Lord as well, and she has never looked back, and she's actually a full-time missionary now, so God is, like, ridiculously amazing. So the Lord was giving me the desire to be obedient, the strength to be obedient, and then when I was obedient, he blessed my socks off, so he's such a good God. So the past 13 years have been an amazing journey of sanctification and growth and understanding, and I'm so thankful for that, and he's continuing to do that in all of us. I'm thankful that he has raised me up for a ministry that helps better understand the LGBT community toward the church, but God's real calling is for me to minister to the church, because the church needs to know how to better love those that are different with them, how to better love and come alongside the LGBT community, even if they never surrender their life to the Lord, or even if they surrender their life to the Lord and they can't seem to stop the same-sex attraction, or they're still confused about their gender. God doesn't call us to fix people. He calls us to love them. So my ministry, there's my website's acting a little funky right now, but my web guy's working on it, but my website is www.outofegyptministries.org. There should still be some cards left out on a table in the foyer. I'm in the common area. There's a resource page. There's a sign-up sheet if you want prayer, and there's cards which have the website, my email, and a phone number on there. And if you have people that you want to be prayed for, I have a prayer team in North Carolina, actually. That's a God's story. But if you write your prayer request on there, just put first name, how old they are, and if they have a partner in their partner's name, so we can begin praying for them. So I want to share, I shared the last service, what parents can do, some things that will help and bless parents when their child, if their child comes out to them. But I think the Lord would have me to share with you guys just what you can do to share Christ with your friends in the gay community. So we're going to go there. I don't know. We were hoping the first one was taped. We're not sure if that's actually going to work. But if it doesn't, you can go again onto my website, and you can hear a similar teaching to that on my website. And if it's not working, just give it a couple days and try again, and hopefully it'll be up at that point. But if we were to ask our gay friends if they considered themselves odd or different because they were gay, they might reply with something kind of like this. Nope, I'm normal just like everyone else. So if we look at that word normal, Webster's dictionary defines normal as usual, ordinary, not strange, occurring naturally. So just like the definition of normal reads, a gay person will see themselves as usual and ordinary, and that their homosexuality occurred naturally, saying they were born that way. You see, to most gay people, their homosexual feelings and desires are all they've ever known, all they can remember having. They feel that that's a part of who they are. That is who they are. Their desires are normal to them because that's all they've ever felt, and all they've ever had is a physical or even a sexual desire. So to tell a gay person the way that they're feeling and therefore probably living is wrong or not natural is like telling them that the essence of who they are is wrong, that their sexuality, you know, is their identity, so they're not going to understand that most likely. Therefore, we have to be mindful. Please be mindful with how you begin a dialogue about the gospel with someone who's gay. Remember, the dialogue's about the gospel. But if we begin by telling them the Bible says homosexuality is sinful and they need to repent and stop living that way, not only will they not be able to understand, but most likely they're going to become angry. They're not going to understand why God's telling them to stop something that's normal and natural to them. You know, hey, God created me this way. What's he going to tell me now that I can't live this way? So they're not going to understand. So starting a dialogue, talking to them about their sin is like putting the cart before the horse. We first have to tell them about Jesus. Tell them about the gospel before we tell them about themselves and the sinful way that they're living. Listen, I believe they need to hear the love of Christ before they hear the law of Moses. Okay? Both are important. I know I did. Even though God answered my question of whether or not I was living homosexually, if that was wrong, he answered it by taking me to the Levitical law, but I did not surrender my life to him until he told me and showed me that he loved me. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay. Martin Luther says it this way: the law discovers the disease, the gospel gives the remedy. Give them the remedy. Deep inside, they already know there's some type of disease before they got saved. Didn't you? Right? So if they're interested in talking about God, just share a few foundational truths. Number one, there's only one God, and he's perfectly holy and perfectly just in all things, and he doesn't make mistakes. There's so many people that are in the LGBT community that want to be part of the church, but oftentimes they don't feel welcomed in the evangelical church, so they start going to other churches, all-inclusive churches. It's almost like you get the free all-inclusive band, you know, and you go walk in. But in a lot of these churches, some of them are Unitarian, and they say that there's, you know, all roads lead to God, and there's many other gods. So we have to just remind them that there's only one God, and he's perfectly holy, and he's perfectly just, and he doesn't make mistakes. Number two, remind them that God loves us with an everlasting love. Maybe they've never heard that before. Maybe some of them have, but they feel like God's love has left them, because many people in the LGBT community were raised in Christian churches. And then once they shared with someone what they were going through and how they felt rejected, and they left the church. So we need to remind them that God loves them with an everlasting love, and nothing they can do or have done will separate them from that love. Number three, remind them or inform them that we all have a sin nature that separates us from this holy God, and that the Lord has made a way to bridge this separation and then explain to them who Jesus is, then share the gospel with them. And we need to remember that there's only two types of people on the earth, those that are living under Adam and those that are living in Christ. And if you want to read further about that, you can in Romans 5, verses 12 through 21. And if someone's living under Adam, they're not going to fully understand the things in Christ. So just keep sharing that with them. Now, I want you to notice that in those things that I shared, that there's nothing about homosexuality. We must approach the LGBT community with the gospel the same exact way we approach anyone else in our family or community. Hear this, please. Don't let the fact that they're gay intimidate you into sharing the gospel with them in a different way. There's only two people. It's not gay and straight. It's Adam or Christ. So share with them the same way you would with anyone else that's living under Adam. So there's no difference between those who are unredeemed. It's not like hell is filled with homosexuals. Hell is filled with unredeemed people that have rejected Jesus Christ. So if we don't point out other people's sins right off the bat, why do we feel it necessary to do that with those who are homosexual? There's absolutely no need for that. When you share Christ with your straight coworker that's living with, you know, his girlfriend, do you take them to 1 Corinthians 6, 9, and 10 and say, you know, it says right here, fornicators are not going to inherit the kingdom of God? Or do you take them to John 3, 16? Do the same, please, with those who identify as any letter of the LGBTQP community. Please, they're really no different. And again, listen, homosexuality isn't their only sin. And it's not their biggest sin, for that matter. We all share in the same sin, and that's pride, okay? Pride is our biggest adversary, and it rears its ugly head all the time. And you can even let them know, you know, if they start asking you, well, the Bible says this. Well, the Bible says, you know, that homosexuality, man with man, is an abomination. And you could say, well, hold up. Hang on one second. The Bible says I'm an abomination too. And they'll be like, whoa, what? And you could say, yeah. Proverbs 16:5 says, everyone who's proud in heart is an abomination to the Lord. So, dude, we're on the same level. But listen, I give the Lord my pride when it rises up. Because I believe in the Lord, I have the Holy Spirit living inside of me, and I have this thing called conviction when I sin. And now when the Lord convicts me for my pride, I can bring it before him and give it to him. And guess what? You can do the same thing. Do you struggle with pride? Do you struggle with lust? Do you struggle with wanting the things that your neighbors want? Listen, man, I do too. Point out the commonalities that you have, not the differences. No one particular sin is better or worse than the other. It separates us from God, all of us, especially pride. So talk to them about their other sins. And as they become comfortable repenting over their pride and repenting over their lust and repenting over stealing from work or whatever it might be, then they're going to be more prone to eventually hear the Lord when he starts to convict them about their homosexuality. Does that make sense? All right. So again, I hope in all of this you've noticed that the way to share Christ with the homosexual is the same way that you share it with anyone else. And yes, Sandy, with love, because love never fails. And I heard you guys, I saw a lot of you shaking your head when you said you believe every word of the Bible. So if you believe that love never fails, then don't be afraid to love. God will do the rest. Amen. Praise the Lord. Pastor Eric, you want to pray?
Thank you so much, Patty. Come on, just thank God for Patty. What a wonderful blessing.
Isn't God ridiculously
yes.
awesome?
Amen.
He's so good.
You know, just wanted to encourage you today. It's just wonderful. No matter what you've been through, God is the God that raises up the dead. Maybe you had a dead marriage. Maybe you made some bad mistakes in your life. Maybe you're not struggling with same-sex attraction. Maybe you're struggling with all sorts of things. But maybe you are struggling with these things today. But know this, God is an expert at raising what was considered dead to life. And I just wanted to mention to you as we conclude today is, and it's found in the Bible. Jesus said this: I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. So whatever you're going through today, know this. Jesus does not ask you to change everything off. First, he says, I am the way. I am the way. So I don't know where to go. How do I change, God? How do I change my life? How do I get out of the situation? Well, I am the way. So accept Jesus is the way. He doesn't show us the way. He is the way. He says, I am the truth. Doesn't say I have truth. He says, I am truth. And you will know the truth. And the word in Greek is gnosko. You shall know the truth, which is me. And me will set you free. And I am the life. Zoe, I'm life. I am the way, I'm the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So, rather than try to change everything at once, that's complicated, and it won't work. I've tried. Even today, I try. I got to stop doing this. I got to stop doing this. I got to change my attitude. You know what I find? Never works. You know what works? Jesus, I surrender to you. And as I surrender, he gives me the power to change. The Bible says, seek what? First, the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things will be added, including getting through stuff. And so, I don't know where you are today, but I'd like to do right now is a couple of things. Number one, I want to pray for those that have never surrendered their lives to Christ. Patty did that, and you can too. If you're struggling with same-sex attraction, if you're involved in a relationship like that, listen, Jesus loves you. He loves you so much. He wants you to find freedom. Your sexuality does not determine who you are. Your Savior does. Understand that. And everything. Your sin does not define you. Your Savior does. And so right now, I'd like you to do, if you could just bow your heads. I want to have a chance to pray with you this morning. And if you'll pray this prayer and you'll mean it from your heart, it's not the words that make the difference. It's the heart connecting to the words of Jesus Christ. And so what I'd like to do right now, if you're tired of living your life the way you're living and you're saying, you know what, I want to get my life right with God. I realize I'm doing it my own way. I want to surrender my past, and I want to give my life to Christ for the very first time. Or perhaps maybe you knew Christ and you fell away, and you're like, I want to get back right with God. I'm going to ask you to pray this prayer with me and follow along with me. Let's pray right now. If you'll pray this prayer, that today can be a new beginning, because it's not what you do, it's what he's done. Lord Jesus, I thank you for dying. You should pray after me. Lord Jesus, I thank you for dying on the cross for me. I believe you are the Son of God. I believe that you died on the cross to pay for all of my sins. I receive your forgiveness. I ask you to forgive me, for I am a sinner. I've missed the mark. And I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins. And right now I confess these things to you right now. Just take a moment. And confess those things right now to the Lord in your own way. Thank you that you've heard my sins and that you forgive me. Thank you that if I confess my sins to you, you're faithful to forgive me of all sins. I now turn my life over to you. I declare my life is no longer my own. I entrust you, the maker and the lover of my life. God, I give you my life. And I declare that you are the boss and not me. And with your help, I will follow you all the days of my life. With every head bowed, you'd say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer today for the first time, or I've made a new commitment. Just real quick, just a quick show of hands. Thank you. Anyone else today? Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else? Come on, there's a couple of others. Thank you. Thank you. Come on, everybody. Let's just thank the Lord this morning. Let's just thank the Lord. Amen. Well, four or five of you this morning that have done it. Anyone watching at home or wherever you are, or you know, wherever you are watching it online through live stream, we want to encourage you. If you'd open your bulletins, your worship guides, it's a little blue thing here. You see it? Inside there's a card. We talked about it initially before. And I'm also going to ask those that are ready to give to get ready to give as well, as we have our tithes and our offerings. But for those of you that have prayed that prayer for the first time or recommitted their lives, you can see connection card. It says, my commitment, I commit my life to Christ today. We want to help you with the next steps that are going to go. So just take a few moments and get that card out if you could. And you can fill that out. I'm going to ask everyone else to get ready for your giving at this time. We're going to have our offering in a few moments. And before we do that, I just want to mention a few things. It's real simple. Just start. Just start. We have Bibles for you outside. We're going to have a prayer team up here. And if you'd be so kind to fill out your name and your address, we'll contact you, if you long to, with a letter, and we'll help you through this process, okay? And so that's what we want to do, and so let's just take a moment. I want to pray for the rest of us right now, because we're all in this together. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you so much for what you said through Patty this morning, Lord. The beautiful light of your love shining through her life like a prism is bringing forth the truth from her life. Father, I thank you that you made her pain an amazing story. And Father, I pray for the rest of us right now that are struggling with relationship issues, that are struggling with situations. I pray for those of us that have perhaps our children or family, friends that are struggling with same-sex attraction or struggling with sin in general. Father, we recognize all sin separates us from you. And Father, we just pray right now that we would find freedom, that we would love those. And Father, I pray that you'd send us people that are struggling, that we could show them your love, that this would be a safe landing place for people to get set free and find who they are in you. And Father, I pray you meet every single need here this morning in Jesus' name. And Father, I also pray you bless this offering. It be utilized to spread forth your kingdom in Jesus' name. If you'd also like to give and beyond your tithe and offering to Patty and her ministry, just put on there Patty at the bottom, and we'd love to be able to help her and her ministry, what she's doing. She's going across the country sharing, and even internationally she'll start sharing as well. And so God is doing a great thing through her. And I'm just so proud that we can participate in spreading this life news of Jesus Christ. So let's go ahead and begin to give at this time. We could do that. And as we're doing that, real quick, I want to say one more thing. We have two more things. We have Growth Track today, step three, discovery. If you've been coming to this church and you're like, how do I get involved? Today is a perfect time for you. We'll have a class. We're going to help you discover your gifts and how you can make a difference with other people. Right after this today, on the right-hand side, there's a conference room. It says Growth Track, Step 3. We have a tremendous communicator this morning. Cynthia's going to do a great job sharing about finding your gifts. We're also having a wonderful meal that's provided. We have extra spaces at the table and childcare. You can't go wrong. Right after this at 12:30 at the right-hand side in the conference room, count yourself invited. And then finally, tonight at 6 p.m., Patty will be sharing with our youth about her life story and how to get free and how to walk in freedom. And I know some parents want to come as well. We're going to see what happens. If we need to, we can come in here. We run out of space. But I'm excited about tonight because make no mistake, our society and our kids are being told one thing. Isn't it good to show them the truth? Amen, everybody? Let's all stand as we have a concluding song. As we do that, we're going to ask our prayer team to come down. If you need anything at all, prayer, we want to be able to pray with you. Okay, we're going to dismiss, but we're going to leave the altars open. If you want to talk to Patty as well, she'll be happy to talk with you and pray with you. Let's conclude our time with a song. Thank you.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
Come on, let's lift it up.
And all will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing.
Father, we thank you for your life. We bless you. We honor you. And we thank you for this time today. In Jesus' name, go in the grace and the love of his power. Listen, we want to leave the front open. If you need prayer for anything at all, we want to be able to pray with you. God bless you, and let's walk in his life. Amen.